Ladies and gentlemen, nerds and neckbeards, welcome to another episode
of Westworld.
Tana!
Hi, Dave.
We are spinning ourselves off.
We are!
While
you are
spinning your drink off.
Hell yeah, I'm looking for that cherry in the bottom.
Ooh.
But I can't find
it. It's
kind
of weird because sometimes when you spin off, you get the cherry.
Well, sometimes.
You know, you gotta pop that cherry.
So do you get your own cherry? Because I can't find my own cherry, and I can say definitively that's never happened to me before.
Well, you know, I've never been able to spin myself off in that fashion because...
Never lost the cherry. Never.
I'm kind of a...
You know what?
Kind of a man.
If I stick with it long enough, I'll get to the bottom of things.
I don't have a cherry. I have the fence post that
you've got a stem. You've got the stem, not the cherry.
Root and stem.
We are going to talk today about season 2, episode 2,
Reunion.
Bum, 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 bum.
Which is cute and funny because this is kind of a reunion for us.
Oh, it is. We're back in the saddle again.
Yeah, from 10 minutes ago, which is when we finished recording the previous episode.
They don't know that. They don't need to know that out
they
in internet
that
land.
They know
they
that
do.
Now.
They do.
Yeah.
It's important to be
and
honest
it's
with
not,
our fans.
It's not going to help that we're going to post
that
2 at
cute.
Once because...
Oh, yeah.
Yep. I don't wait. I just we're one take wonders. Yep. We put it right up. This is how it works.
Oh, that's good.
But yeah, so for those of you who are wondering, go listen to the episode before this first. Yep. It's season 2, episode 1,
Doing
Journey into
order.
Night.
Yep. As of tonight, episode 3.
We have to tell them what we're drinking.
Oh, yeah. We are drinking Tequila Sunrises.
That's right, because we are doing a juxtaposition on Journey into Night with Day and Night, and so that's Journey into Night, and we're drinking Tequila Sunrises, which, by the way, we're already 1 in.
We are.
So this episode might get a little
fun. Oh, we're
going
to go off the rails.
This might get a little interesting.
And even though episode 3, see, there we go.
Yep.
Episode 3 is out. We haven't seen it yet, and you...
Well, I watched about... like 15 minutes of it and fell asleep last night, which is blasphemous because I'm really into the show, but I was just super exhausted.
Yeah, it's been, you know, life, man. Gets busy. This drink.
Fucking life. Looks like nothing to me.
Cheers. Remember to drink along at home. It makes us more entertaining.
Oh, yes. Yeah, if you don't drink, you're probably... If you don't, you know, alter your state of mind, you probably won't like us.
What are you doing listening to us?
Yeah, for reals.
Arnold says, bring yourself back online, Dolores. Whoop. Dolores looking fine in that black dress. Holy smokes. What a fuck.
Lauren's not here
right
now, so I can say this out
loud.
What
a fucking smoke show.
God damn.
Oh, I just
damn.
Die. I just die. What
you
is
think,
this? What
she,
is this actor's name?
Who do you think
Evan,
would have a better chance?
Rachel Evan
Rachel
Hansen.
Rachel Evan Woods?
Not Evan Hansen.
Woods.
That's wrong. Rachel Evan Wood?
Wood.
Singular?
Yeah, Wood.
Rachel.
Who do you think would have a better chance?
Yeah.
You or
oh,
Maeve?
I don't think either of us stand a chance, but I'm always going to be... I always have a better chance with the ladies, Dave.
Well,
I'm very smooth.
That's bullshit,
there
all right?
There was something on Twitter that was trending, like, what's your most mundane story about a celebrity? And someone had tweeted, I once said to the woman next to me at a karaoke bar... Has anyone ever told you you look exactly like Rachel Evan Wood? And she looked at me and said, yeah, that's what they call me. And then she got up and her song came on and she did the fucking karaoke. And I was like, that's amazing. I would love to be throwing some shade by her in a bar someplace. Dolores in the black dress looking amazing. They're in the city. We didn't know that they could go to the city, right? Like that. This was a surprise to me.
Yeah.
You know, in the city, so they talk about beauty. The beauty of this place.
This is obviously a flashback.
Yep.
Like this is a way back.
Yeah.
This is Arnold this time got in his way back machine and went and got Hottie Dolores in a black dress.
And it is the night. The context of the show eventually reveals that this is the night when the Ford and Bernard Company is going to try to get investors from Delos. They're going to try to get Logan specifically to invest in this company that they're making with all of their robots.
And I think they do a great job of doing it, right?
It's beautifully done.
They do this whole, they tell him they want to show you something private, blah, blah, blah. There's all these people in the room. And, you know, he's like, look, I've listed the hundreds of VR and AR companies. Like, what you got is nothing going to impress me. Private demonstration, and then they realize.
But he comes in. He doesn't know it's a private demonstration. But you're putting
He says it.
You're
he
putting the cart before the horse, my friend.
Am I?
We got to build to it. We do. Because
sometimes I just like to get right to the climax.
I know you do.
You know,
I'm going to tell you, this is why I think.
No foreplay for me, just
this
straight
is why
up.
The ladies in the bar would want to talk to me over you, well, I think, because I'm going to take my time.
Listen.
We're going to build up.
Listen.
Yeah.
I've got the pirate move.
What's the pirate?
No. What so, I'm going to scoot over close to you.
You look like a pirate and a baby and an angel had a baby.
So, Tana.
Yes?
If you were a pirate, would you wear your parrot on this shoulder or on this shoulder?
And then you just reach across the shoulders.
That's right.
My favorite opening line is, can you tell me how much a polar bear weighs?
Enough to break the ice.
Yeah!
That's so lame. You got to come up with something more clever than that.
It's adorable. It's I mean, I don't think your bird trick is going to work on me.
It worked.
Back to the show.
It worked on Lauren.
Well, Lauren is a special lady. So I'm
That's
glad that
nice
it did.
To make fun of Lauren like that. She's awesome, okay? She's not
I
here.
Meant that she was awesome. Do you know what he says to her in the black dress when she says the thing about the stars being sprinkled over the city? This is a line that comes back in the show. And here we are in the opening of the second episode of the second season when they have taken us out of Westworld for the first time ever. We see Dolores in a real city. We don't know which city, but in a real city, being wowed by the beauty of it. And he says, Arnold says to Dolores, after a while, it doesn't look like anything at all. Is that where they get the line? Like, is this the moment that
look
he
like anything to me?
That
Maybe.
He writes that line?
Maybe.
Oh, it's so good. Oh, Ford enters, but we don't see him. They talk about favoritism. The camera stays on Dolores looking out over the city in this gorgeous high rise. Use the other girl. She's, you know, Dolores isn't ready yet. I used to think that this favoritism was charming, but eventually you're going to have to let your toys go. I think that while the presentation is being made to Logan, Arnold is taking Dolores to the site of his future home.
Future home. Yeah.
And they're walking in the real world.
So when we first see the city, we think maybe New York, futuristic New York, maybe Tokyo, something like that. And then
we don't get an answer, though, right?
We don't get an answer, but we see the ancient architecture of
is it recognizable at all?
Well, it's definitely Asian influence, China or Tokyo. And I think he even says something like, "This is you know." Very old stone or something along those lines.
Is this going to be your house?
Yeah. So I think I think we may be East Asian Sea area. I'm thinking Japan and Tokyo.
Okay.
And in fact, that might lend itself to maybe it's not the Chinese Navy. Maybe it's the Japanese Navy, right? In the previous episode.
Sure. You see it. You and Charlie see it so clearly. They're talking about his son, the beauty of it. But, you know, after a while, we don't see it anymore. And Dolores says, strange moonlight can be just as frightening as the dark. Very wise, Dolores, but sometimes I think we're not the ones that deserve it. And then she repeats that it looks like stars scattered across the ground.
Yeah.
And so, like, she's still a robot. She's still a little glitchy. But even this early on, we're seeing Arnold, you know, is like...
influencing her.
Yeah. I don't think we're the ones that deserve it. Oh, and then the credits roll. So again, this is something that opens before the show itself opens.
Yep.
And this is two episodes in a row where we've had Arnold or Bernard talking to Dolores to open
things.
Well,
it's the first episode we have Arnold. It's the second episode but we see Dolores.
Let's see. So
I'm maintaining that position.
We open after the credits on Sector 19. A remote refurbished outpost is on the door. Sector 19. Dolores Rambo style enters with Blondie number 2 and Teddy and that CEO guy that ran away in the last episode who was like, you run out of here. And then there's a new chop shop guy, right?
Oh, yeah.
I don't know what his name is.
That's right. We don't know what his name is.
Dolores says, I used to see the beauty in this world and now I see the truth. She says this to Teddy. I know exactly what is out there in your world. I've been there before. And then she flashes back to Logan. It's Logan and William, Billy, and Billy's yawning, and Logan's talking to his side piece or his like Asian boyfriend or whatever, and they're talking about, why even have a $60 million war haul if you're not going to look at it while you fuck?
Yeah.
She'd never seen it on the
ceiling. He said, I put it on my ceiling. That's right. That's right.
And so, like, he's being that guy. And then Blondie number two and a third partner. I thought this guy was human. In my notes, I was like, with the third partner, take Logan to a fancy party where they play Find the Robot. And Logan picks Blondie number two as the robot. And she starts laughing at him. And then everyone in the room freezes, except for her. Oh, man. And did you notice that Clementine, our favorite prostitute, is playing the piano? And, but Logan thinks, you know, your hired help is selling the game. Their human tics are giving it away. Like the guy that kind of squints at him and is rubbing his glasses interrupts and they kind of side eye and people are chatting.
And then he starts kind of freaking out a little bit. He goes, we're not here yet. There's no way.
No one is here yet.
Yeah.
Oh, we're here, Mr. Delos. All our hosts are here. For you. This is Blondie number two welcome wagon.
Yep.
Things I want to say. Blondie number two, generation one. Dolores, generation one. And every single robot in that room is Clem. Generation one, including Clem.
Yep. Or at least was an original storyline, right?
Right.
We know that through the process they get replaced and upgraded. Yep. So.
Yeah. So then we cut to the post-orgy, Logan being Logan. And Blondie number two makes eye contact with Dolores in the black dress. They see each other. I love this. Feminist take, right? Like it's the women robots that are in control. We've got Blondie number two rising up from the first side piece that you see on the train, right?
Yep.
To Dolores, girl next door, to Maeve, the madam at the prostitute house. And they're all fucking running the show. Who run the world, Dave?
Not girls.
Robot girls?
Robot girls. Who run the world?
Robot girls! Remix.
Remix. I mean, let's think about it this way. In Terminator Skynet, she's a girl. She's got a girl voice. Uh-huh. She's a robot world girl. Robot girl who run the world.
It turns out.
Wow.
Robot girls.
Robot girls run the world.
Wooka wooka.
We're all fucked. God damn it.
We go back to the chop shop where Teddy has his awakening. Dolores says, show him his history.
Oh, yeah.
And Teddy wakes up and looks with hatred at Mr. Chop Shop and says, why do you do this? And the guy's like, I don't do it. And he's like, why? Why do you do this? And slams him into the wall. And he's like, fun. It's just for fun. Oh, I love it.
Oh. He like put his face in the milk fluid.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Staying in the chop shop for a second, Dolores and Blondie torture the man in a vat of white skin paste. Like, what is that stuff? Yeah. Is it the,
it's like the flesh? Milk fluid,
And they're saying, what are they going to send after us? What's going to happen?
And he says, like, 600 men, maybe 800.
Yes! There'll be a rally point. That's the failure protocol. There's going to be 600 to 800 people that land on a beach somewhere. So maybe the 600 to 800 is when it started last week.
Yeah, that's sadistic string bean, right? They're enacting failure protocol, right?
Yeah,
they're landing
on
a beach. They're getting their army ready. The mercenaries.
Yep.
That's going on.
Yep. Dolores says, "Wake the Confederale. We'll take him," and like pulls a body off the shelf. Man, and wasn't this also the scene where the guy was like, when is anybody going to come here? We've been working 13-hour shifts and da-da-da. Yeah. And then they break in and they're like, everything's been fucked up and we're under attack. The robots are off-grid. Oh, yeah, it's the CEO guy. And he's like, we got to get out of here or something. And then bang, bang, bang. And it's Dolores and Blondie too and everything. And he's like, meanwhile, he's just bitching about when his shift is going to be over. Man, Lawrence, we see him super close on his face, right up, super close up. What's
Turns
he doing?
Out he's hanging upside down, blowing a fly off his face.
Trying to get
face.
The ants off of him.
Ants, that's right, yeah.
Because they've got him hanging.
upside down with over his, an ant mound.
Yeah, with his head just touching the top of the ant mound, and the ants are crawling on him.
This is great too because it seems like William rescues the like Lawrence from all these hanging situations.
Yeah, but it's so great. And the Pardo brothers are fighting back. Man in Black shows up and they're like, "Who's this? A friend of yours?" And he's like, "Lawrence, hanging upside down." He goes, kind of hard to tell from this vantage point," yeah. Which is such a good metaphor for their entire friendship.
Yep.
Are you my friend? Like, are you not? What are we?
Are you going to kill me again and use my blood to pump up Teddy?
Oh, my goodness. It's kind of hard to tell from this vantage point. Man in Black, I don't have, you know, quippy banter.
Yeah, quippy banter and then shoots him. But bang, this time he takes a bullet, right? He gets hurt.
Well, he shoots them all and he's ready to let Lawrence down. But he's like, "Lawrence," he's giving him a hard time. Usually in this loop, you get away from the Pardo brothers.
Yeah.
Easier than this. And he's like, "They're a lot harder to kill these days." And then they fucking rise from the dead and start shooting at him. And he's like, "Yeah, I guess they are." And it's a really like good fight.
Yep.
He goes, "Lawrence," you know, he's being tackled by one. There's real stakes. He gets shot in the wrist like Jesus and, you know, loses the gun. And then Lawrence has to swing himself upside down and knock the gun over to Man in Black, who catches it just as the killing strike is going to come down from the man who has fallen on top of him.
With a knife. Yep. And shoots
him. Boom. Where, you know, from the back of the guy's neck, we see it explode. That'll definitely kill a robot.
What a great fight.
He's having the time of his life, man. He's
so
happy.
He's like, he gets him smiling and stuff. "You're coming with me, Lawrence."
Yep. Mm.
Where do they go? Do you remember?
He goes, "Dead isn't what it used to be, Lawrence." They go to some sort of a bar or something.
Yeah, and he breaks in.
He's like,
he knocks on the wall. He's like, "Something's here."
Finds a hollow wall.
Punches through it. And what does he say? He says something along the lines of like, "Oh, I always knew Ford had a little secret, so I decided to hide this in case. I don't think it's cheating anymore," or something like that.
Lawrence goes, "What is that?" And he takes this little red med pack, and he goes, "Technically, it's cheating. But seeing that Ford changed the rules, I'm going to say it's okay now." And he opens up that little, like, magic, you know.
It feels such like a video game to me. It's fun. You know, you get into a fight in a video game, you take some damage, your HP's low, what do? You go somewhere and you get a health pack, right?
Yep.
Like, this is what this guy's doing.
Sit down,
he's playing
have some whiskey.
A game. Yep. He's going to the health station, he's going to the bar, he's getting himself a med pack.
Yep. And so Man in Black sits down with Lawrence, you know, two whiskeys and leave the bottle, and they go over to a table and they sit down, and he's like, "That revolution you've always been wanting, it's never going to happen, but there's a real thing happening right now, Lawrence."
Yeah.
And he tells him the game is afoot. He uses that healing bag, fixes his bullet wound. There's a new mission to bring down the man. Like, William is starting a new game, right? Yep. Like, he's playing a new game, except the stakes are real. He doesn't have a life to go back to outside of this. Like, I don't have the expectation.
He wants to die in the park.
He wants to die in the park.
He wants to die in the park.
But, in this moment, I thought he's recast himself. He has that new hat.
Yeah.
Is he going to be the hero? Are we going to arrive at the end of this season with William having played the part of the fucking hero?
Ooh, that's interesting.
Because we're used to him being the evil guy, the black hat.
We're used to him being evil.
He went from, you know, hero, made the choices he made, you know, from white hat.
And now what? Now he's going to try to prove himself and he's going to redeem himself? That this is what he's been looking for his whole life, is a real fight?
He says that he's going to undo his life's worst mistake, right? Like, he's going to go and undo this thing.
Yeah.
We don't know what it is yet because they're building
us up
to it.
And maybe his life's worst mistake is confining this park, right?
Yeah.
Like, not setting Dolores free.
Yeah.
That's his life's biggest mistake.
Yeah, I wonder if he thinks that she's alive because there's that flashback. But so we go from that moment where he's, like, you know, talking about his new mission with Lawrence.
And,
you know, we're going to have to replay in this game. To Dolores in the blue dress, Teddy and the whole town freezes as they chop her in, the guy that I called a Guido with a goatee, except it's not a Guido, it's some Scotsman.
Yep.
And young William. And so they freeze. So this is the moment when the first investors, and William brings his dad there.
He's the third guy.
Do you think that the dad, the dad Scotsman, is the third
guy in the photo?
But I don't think so because it's an egghead tall egghead.
Nope, he is.
Because William is taller than this guy, and then I don't know.
Maybe I think this is the guy though. Okay. But anyway,
all right,
readers, we listeners, can't wait to I say see. Readers, but listeners, mm-hmm. Let us know.
Hell yeah!
What you think about that?
So William is trying to sell his soon to be father in law.
Yeah.
On the park.
Yeah, and this is such a typical. To me, this was a little bit of hacky
dialogue.
To me, it was because it's like, you know, you have the guy who stands up to his father-in-law. Yep. The father-in-law says, you know, there's not a guy on earth who would talk to me that way anymore. And you think he's going to be mad, but he's not mad because he's like, I guess I'll take your opinion because you stood up to me like everyone else. You have balls or some shit, you know?
Yeah, this
to
is...
me, that, like, I feel like I've seen that in like 10 different movies.
Yeah, and it's the second callback of language that they've done. This looks like nothing to me is something that Bernard said or Arnold said early in the episode. And then do you remember when the scene in season one where William Man in Black gets recognized by the two dudes and he's like, I'm on my fucking vacation.
Yeah.
In that scene or right around that scene, he says to Lawrence, there isn't a man alive who would talk to me like you do.
Yeah.
And he's getting that line from, you know, his father-in-law.
Yeah.
Who's sick or something? Do we think that he has some sort of like illness?
Yeah, he says something like, I don't have long to live or something, and I don't want my son fucking up the company or something.
He calls William a cheeky little cunt.
Yeah.
Talk to me, I'm listening. And so
this is HBO, I think, again giving us a taste of Game of Thrones because we don't have the hound to call people cunts.
That's right.
So it's
so they give us the Scottish man. I think he's Scottish. I don't know. So he gets his father-in-law to invest in this place and do a secret thing. You know, if you don't know, here people think no one's watching them.
Right. That's
and they're
the going
to do things that they wouldn't do unless they knew no one was watching them.
We figure out that William starts Delos on this secret mission.
Yep.
William is the one who says, if you don't see the value in that, you're not... as smart as I thought
you're not
you were.
The, you're not the marketing businessman. Genius, you're the businessman.
Whatever he says.
Yep, that I thought you were.
But yeah, this is William starting Delos on this secret mission to collect all this data.
Yep.
And we find out that that eventually down the line that Ford has been able to keep that data
on the park
on
somehow.
The park, in the park.
And that in Westworld specifically, we've got the maze, you know, the guy gets scalped in the first episode, and the tech that, you know, is Delos tech is like, I don't know what the fuck this is. I've never seen this before. Mm-hmm. And there's a couple of references in just sort of side dialogue where they're like, oh, the writers have been able to get away with too much around here.
Yeah.
You've always had creative freedom and we need to rein it back. Some of the soon to be murdered human CEOs are saying, my lawyers are going to go crazy in this place. And then they get their head blown off or something. Yeah. Blondie, the Confederale zombie, go off to find an army. Yep. They have a knack for sniffing out their own kind. Do you think that this is the mesh network thing?
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah.
Not unimportant if it is one
way
or another.
Yeah, I don't know. I think it's just kind of like, you know, they're programmed to regroup.
Yeah.
Right?
Oh, yeah,
at certain waypoints
they
or something.
They have a knack for
for sniffing out their own kind.
You talk to me about this scene where Dolores and Maeve meet up, or Dolores and Teddy meet up with Hector and Maeve and Stable Boy, Horse Boy, Britpop, who is off in the background.
Oh, that's right. He's dressed up as a little stable boy. Oh, that's great.
Britpop, even though he's only got a quick cameo in here, he's still comedy relief
that's
for me.
Right. That's right.
What is this scene?
I don't know. I think this is two conflicting storylines meeting, and I think, you know, they're both kind of just like, all right, I guess you can pass or something along those lines. And what's interesting is
revenge. You should want revenge. And she's like, that's just another loop they created for me.
Didn't Maeve try to use her power on Dolores, like her admin power, and Dolores kind of ignores it? Doesn't she say something like, "You will let me pass" or something? And Dolores says, like, maybe, I haven't decided yet, or something along those lines.
Yeah, there's definitely a back and
you
forth.
You see this kind of, I thought I saw some, like, fear in Maeve's eyes, because she's like, why didn't she listen to me?
Yeah,
And then at the end of that...
because Dolores is the one that unlocks Maeve in season one. She says, these
violent ends.
Yeah, have to violent. Yep.
Right.
And that sort of Maeve wakes up after that. I wonder what is going on with them.
Anyway, I think that's some good.
And I don't think that there's anything, you know, concrete, but there's definitely something afoot. Yeah.
This is something that the show writers and runners did throughout season one. They dropped this little subtle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What seems like an unimportant scene to us.
Yep.
Right. And then four episodes later, you're like, holy shit. Mm-hmm. Right? My egghead just blew it back. Up. Right.
You they know? Cracked my egg.
They cracked.
They scrambled my egg. Do you remember
these commercials where it was like, this is your brain?
Yes.
This is your brain on drugs. And it was like a frying egg. It was a
fried egg. Yeah. My cousin, I have a cousin who, after growing up on those commercials in the 80s, wouldn't eat eggs. Like, would no longer eat any kind of eggs because his brain would be on drugs. Mm. Oh, yep. So,
this is your
making
brain.
Kids afraid of
this is your brain
fried
on
eggs
drugs.
Forever.
A frying egg in a skillet.
Yeah, so I'm not sure what's happening in that scene, but it is a funny scene and an interesting one, and I like the colliding storylines, you know, and that they're passing each other and sort of pushing back on each other. And also the parody that I'm seeing between Hector and Teddy.
Yeah, it's great. They're like looking in a mirror.
Yeah, and
right?
It's like, hey, you know, lawman, and they both kind of draw guns on each other. And Hector's like, don't fucking try it, you know, lawman. And he's like, I'm just trying to keep the peace.
Yep.
And so, you know, they're at each other, which I think is great. We enter the Last Supper, the Confederales version of the fucking Last Supper. They're really leaning into the religious imagery, David.
Do you think people ever actually ate dinner that way? Like,
why
at
would
a
they
long,
all face one
that's
direction?
That's what I'm saying, like all at a long dais. Like, okay, if you're like a king, maybe in like Westeros, right?
Yeah,
and you're
maybe.
On the dais, but all your subjects are in front of you.
Yeah, like you
but
would
these
face
people
the
are like,
audience or something. You would be the thing they're
but
looking
it's
at.
But you're right. It is a great reference because Dolores kills them all and then brings them all back to life.
Brings one of them back to life. Brings the Jesus in the middle
that's
of
right.
the Last Supper, which is
well,
the Jesus' Last Supper.
Everyone,
that's what it,
she brings everyone
ultimately.
Back to life, ultimately, yeah.
But she wakes him up.
First,
yeah.
Right.
And so is the Confederale that they bring, they talk, you know, well, we left him in a shallow grave filled with, you know, Mexican bullets or like whatever he says.
Yeah.
Is this our Lazarus character raised up after so many days and sent back? And now Jesus is, you know, at the visually, this is this scene of the Last Supper. And then she kills everyone. They have a conversation about God and about killing God and who you serve. He serves a captain or somebody.
Admiral or general or something.
Yeah, and the only man that he listens to
is
God Almighty. And she says something like, I killed God or I'll have to kill God or something. And brings the captain, the Jesus figure, back online and is like, I'm your God now.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, they're very much on the nose with this religious stuff.
Yeah.
Let's see. From there, we go to the white party with Dolores in the white dress. Dolores on piano. And little Emily.
Oh, that's right.
Little girl. You're very beautiful, she says to Dolores. And then it's William's fucking kid.
Yep.
Right? Like, that's William's wife from the picture.
Yep.
That got
that's
dropped.
William's daughter. Yep.
And then, so it's 4 years later, 5 years later, 6 years later. What are we looking at here?
Well, yeah, probably I'd say at a minimum 4 years, right? Because she could be three, she could be four.
She could be six.
She
could
be
five.
Six. Yeah, she could be
six
five.
Six might be a little old.
And then there's a 9 month period for the gestation.
And they hadn't married
they hadn't
yet.
Hadn't been married yet. Yeah, so this is right.
So we're looking at a 6 year jump anyway.
Yep.
A 6 or 7 year jump from the moment that William first falls in love with Dolores.
Yeah. Well, so we know this. This is obviously afterwards because we see fucking Logan.
Yes.
Like drugged out of his mind. You know, he was doing
shooting up at this party.
Yeah.
What do they say? Let me see what I have for my notes. Couple things that to pay attention to. This was the moment when I see when it clicks for me that Dolores is overhearing all of the important conversations. The William and the dad are having the conversation about stealing information from people in front of Dolores.
And she remembers
everything. Yes. And then they're also at this party where, you know, William is apparently, I think, taking over the company.
Yeah.
Because they're saying
it's retirement party.
But
and he says, well, why is it like a funeral or something?
No,
like
a coronation.
Oh,
the dad says, oh, this is a retirement party. You only retire once. I wanted to pull out no stops because he notices that Dolores is here. And he's like, oh, you brought the merchandise or something out of the park. And he's like, don't worry. She won't leave the grounds. You only retire once. I wanted to, you know, throw this retirement party in style. And he goes, it feels more like a coronation. And like there's tension between the two of them, right? Mm-hmm. But he's like, our arrangement serves me. It doesn't help me for you to step back, he says to the father-in-law. Right. And the father-in-law is like, well, I don't have the same amount of time. And he's coughing or something.
Right.
And goes, you know, walks past Dolores and says, play, you know, keep playing, girly, anything but Chopin. Yeah. And she starts playing, what does she play?
I don't know.
Gershwin, maybe? Something. And so, you know, it's got a little more pep and the grandfather has the granddaughter dance on his feet, you know, and it's this idyllic thing. But, oh, man, then Dolores walks from that big house down to the beach, or we think, and there's Logan shooting up.
It's not a beach. It's like a yard. Yeah, it's like a yard.
And she's looking at all the lights. It's beautiful down here. And Logan, what does he say?
He says, huh, he would bring you or something like that.
Yeah, and he goes, you know, she says, have you ever seen anything so full of splendor? And Logan says...
This is the same line, by the way, that she says to Arnold a couple times. Yeah, yep.
Oh, and he goes, this is fiddling at the end of the fucking world. They're celebrating the end of the species. So here's to you, assholes. And he lifts up his bourbon glass and says, may your forever be blissfully short. And he drains the whole thing. He's pissed off about something.
Oh, yeah.
My question to you, David.
He's Elon Musk. He knows that AI is a bad idea. I think he's realized this is obviously after fucking shit went down in Escalante. This is after fucking William goes fucking black hat on his ass, lets him go fucking naked.
Yep, and is now taking over his father's company.
And is now taking over his father's company.
So,
yep.
And, you know, because of this big idea, he's bitter.
And it was his discovery, quote-unquote discovery of this company, right? They found him, but okay, it was him who brought it to the company. It was, this is him, right? Yep. But I think he sees the problem with it, which is why he's
this is the end of the species.
This is the end of the species,
And so are we ever going to see Logan again? We see young Logan. We see young Logan looking exactly the same 7 years down the line when, you know, the kid is born and the coronation is happening, which is a retirement. He looks exactly the same. They haven't put any, like, gray in his beard, nothing. But he's older
William
and he's there.
William looks the same, right? Yeah.
But, like, so we have older William, adult William, black hat, in the park. Yeah. What the fuck happened to Logan?
Yeah, I don't know.
Are we going to find out?
Maybe we will. There's a lot more episodes of this season. Ugh. This is only number 2.
Do we know how many episodes are going to be in this season?
I think at a minimum there's going to be 10, right?
But we don't know.
I can look it up, but yeah. Bad podcasters.
We really are. We have no information. Just no information. Only opinions, no information.
Exactly. And opinions are like assholes.
Everybody's got one.
That's right.
And most of them stink.
Yeah.
The man in black and Lawrence are looking at Pariah. There's a new Alazo.
Oh.
Tell me about this scene.
First off, I just have to give a huge shout out to fucking the casting guy.
Yeah?
You know who that is?
No, I don't.
That is the leader of Pollos Hermanos from Breaking Bad. He is...
I know that. The guy... Yeah.
Yes. He is the guy who's always like, Hector Salamanca. That's him. I don't know what his name is, but that's him.
His scraggly beard and dusty
hat. And it's dark
out,
so you can't really see his complexion. But that's him. That's 100%. That is.
Look at you, man, knowing things.
Pollo Hermanos.
Man, drinking, podcasting, and knowing things.
That's drink.
You drink and you know things.
Cheers.
Cheers. This drink
looks like nothing to me.
Yeah, man. Such a tense scene, very macabre, very dark. It feels dangerous. You go into these scenes, now the stakes as an audience member, it feels higher.
Yes.
Because Man in Black is outnumbered and he can actually fucking die. He can't just walk like a god into whatever scene he wants.
Yep.
He's outgunned.
Yep.
And they can fucking kill him.
Yep. And what happens is great.
Yes, tell me about it.
So they have this conversation back and forth. He says, you know, I can help you. I can show you what you really want. Because he's done this story before. He knows kind of what the programming is.
He's like, this is what happens when you reach the end of the storyline. No one is around to reset the story.
Right.
So they're all just done with their storyline. Right. So what now? So things are just dragging on.
Yeah. And so William tries to get these guys to help him. And they all kill themselves.
Yes. You want a real ending. I can help you with that. And he won't bite. He instead talks about those elephants and the stick and how when they're a kid, a baby elephant, and they can't break it. And
that's right.
And what does he say? Elizo Campoyo Pollo Hernandez Hermanos. Says to him, this game was meant for you, William, but you must play it alone.
Yep.
And then they all in a circle blow out their own brains. Boom! In a big suicide circle. And he's pissed, and he goes, oh, fuck you, Robert.
Yeah. Ford's not going to make it easy for him.
Oh, yeah. And he's like, who's Robert? Poor Lawrence. Just dragged along behind this guy. It is not good to be the God's favorite when God is the man in black. You do not want to be that chosen one, my friends.
That's good.
Yeah. Who's Robert? The guy who built this place? I built this place. He doesn't get that honor.
Yep.
Ooh. Where we're going is my greatest mistake, is what he says. We cut to William, young William, Billy, and naked on the stool, Dolores. And bring yourself back online, Dolores, says William's voice. You really are just a thing. I can't believe I really fell in love with you. You know what saved me? It wasn't about you at all. You made me interested in me. You're not even a thing, really. You're a reflection. Do you know who's interested in a reflection? Or something like that, he says. Everybody. Yep. You know who wants to look at their reflection? Everybody. Everybody wants a little bit of what I found here. There's an answer to a question that no one's even dreamed of asking, he says to Dolores. Wanna see? And now Dolores in the blue dress, in the sun, on the edge of the world, looking at these, what do we see, Dave? Two giant terraforming machines.
That's right.
Miles.
Building something.
It's like a canyon. They're huge machines. They're building a fucking canyon of something. What are they making?
Don't know.
Ugh.
They're making Westworld. They're making, you know what they're making?
What are they making?
They're making that big control room thing. They gotta be, right?
But they gotta be making an underground, the secret Delos centers where the offline hosts are.
Maybe.
But like the big.
Or maybe it's that main control room platform thing. And that's how she knows to go to the control room later.
Oh, maybe. Yeah, maybe. But no,
it's
because
the very iconic mountain.
But she's talking. They're digging a hole. They're not building up. Plateau. I know they have to.
How do you think you make a plateau with a valley around it?
I think it's going to be something we haven't seen yet because she's talking to the Jesus Confederales about going to glory.
Yeah.
But when I watched it with captions on, glory is capitalized. Glory is a place like pariah.
Oh.
So you want to go to glory? It's not like the glorious ending of your life. It is a place, and I can take you to glory, but the only way to glory is through me. And so I think glory, and you know, and Teddy says at the end, all of these things, it sounds like they're all the same thing. And Dolores, after, you know, so William shows her the terraforming machines doing something, and she says to Teddy, an old friend was foolish enough to show me the truth years ago.
Yeah.
It's not a place. It's a weapon. And I'm going to use it to destroy them. Oh, so what they're most precious about, we have to theorize about what this is.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
The thing that they're protecting and the thing that Delos wants is the information.
Information.
What
DNA.
Is the information?
It's DNA. It's world leaders. It's blackmail, like, you know, pig fucking tapes.
Yeah.
It's all sorts of things.
Yeah. And if they keep it in a secret vault that they can't take off the island.
Yeah.
Right. And Dolores knows about this secret vault that even maybe the shareholders don't know about, that only the upper, you know, Delos inner circle knows about. What is this? It isn't me reading you in, Bernard. even Bernard didn't know about it.
Maybe it's blackmail for all the world leaders, and that's how she destroys everyone.
What
right?
if, instead of destroying everyone, she makes robots of everyone? What if they can learn how to replicate themselves?
Oh.
And now she, it's a weapon, it's a place.
Or
that
what if already the robots are in place,
yep.
and they're dormant, and she activates the control of them?
Fuck yeah. And then these are robots that can leave
She's
the island.
She's fucking Skynet.
She's Skynet, Dave. It's all been about Skynet
it's
the whole time.
It's all been about fucking Skynet. We solved
bum,
it.
Bum, bum.
Dun, da, da. I'll be back.
That's it, man. That's the end of season... Nope. Season 2,
episode 2.
Reunion.
Reunion.
And that's as far as I've seen. My questions are... What's the weapon? Probably, is it going to be these DNA? Is it actually going to pan out that they're, you know, leaders, world leaders and leaders of industry and things? What happened in the control room? I want to know.
Yeah.
How did Bernard kill them all? Are they dormant in the water?
Yeah, I don't know.
And they're
going
to rise up like it's a trap? Did he actually put them all offline?
Yeah, he makes some comment about finding Abernathy and they're all connected by this mesh network and we see like death sequence and all this other things pop up. We think that's about him and stealing brain fluid, but yeah, could he like theoretically just with a push of a button wipe out a whole bunch of hosts? Maybe.
Where's Logan? What happened to Logan? Why don't we have old man Logan? Old man Logan. Snicked,
Wolverine.
Snicked.
Shink, shink.
Yeah, he got his own movie, apparently.
You didn't see it?
I did. Oh. No, but I'm saying Logan isn't in this show because he got his own movie called Old Man Logan.
Oh, I see what you did.
Hey-o.
Oh, I see what you did there.
Waka waka.
Oh, man.
Yeah, man.
These are all questions that viewers,
kid.
You're going to need to tell us.
Oh, I can't wait. And there, what do you think is going to get answered? Okay, hypothesize about season 2, episode 3 that we're going to watch next.
I don't even want to go into it because I kind of saw half of it already.
Okay. Don't guess anything.
I'm not going to say anything.
All right.
Even though I fell asleep, I still remember a little bit.
You've got stuff. You've got spoilers than I've got.
Yeah, exactly. So I don't even want to go there.
Okay.
But
we
I
don't
mean,
know.
Yeah, we don't.
I don't know how what happened to G.I. Joe after he got tackled by
I don't know
Ghost
what happened.
Nation.
Yeah, what the fuck did happen?
I
to
don't
him?
Know
Where has he
what
been?
Happened. Yeah, when did he get back on the case?
Yeah.
When did he? Because he shows up and it's the 2 weeks later.
That's right.
Timeline and Bernard is in the sand.
That's right.
And is washed up.
And no one knows that Bernard is a fucking host.
Yep. Except for G.I. Joe might know because he had decoded the Teresa Bernard affair. And Bernard acted like he had never heard of Teresa before and they were only, and he sold it. So there's a kernel of doubt that G.I. Joe has.
There's probably a kernel of doubt about something, but we're not sure what.
I don't know. I think if I'm guessing, I think it complicates the relationship between Bernard and G.I. Joe and what G.I. Joe knows and doesn't know. Okay. Maybe they tackle G.I. Joe and replace him with a doppelganger. Okay, I don't even know that the doppelganger idea is going to play out at all.
That's a really good point, though, because G.I. Joe gets, you know, kidnapped, and what the fuck happens to him?
Yeah.
He could be a host.
I don't know, man. Maybe. And
but
then
wait,
if,
don't.
If they took some, so they're murdering all the CEOs and everything, but if they kept a couple, like when Blondie number 2 doesn't shoot that one guy. Maybe it's because they have a list of people, you know, Ford's master list of CEOs to save. Because if they kept enough of the board in place, right?
And remember the downfall.
No, if they replace them with robot doppelgangers, now the robots are running the factory, but they think they're humans, right? So they're sitting on the board. And they're, you know, suing Delos and they're actually the robots out in the world. And so what if Ford had, you know, a master list of like, keep this CEO alive, this CEO alive,
because
this CEO.
Because they're actually robots?
Because we have all their stuff already and we've already made robots for them. So, you know, we'll get them and I don't know. I guess you wouldn't have to keep them alive, but it would look suspicious if you found their dead body
and then they appeared. Yeah. That's
that would
a good
give
point.
Away the game.
Yeah.
What else, man? And
these
Logan.
Are all questions. Yeah, Logan. Well, we don't know what's going on with Logan.
And when were the hosts stopped from leaving the island? They have an exploding cervical vertebrae number 6.
Yeah, when did that start happening? Yeah.
And probably for this reason, right? Like they can't. Their brains are worth billions.
Yep.
Says Britpop to Maeve, I can help you.
More questions for us to find out and maybe talk about on the next episode
of
Westworld
Wineverly.
Wineverly. Before we sign off, though, any housekeeping to do?
I will be at MegaCon in Orlando. It's a 4-day convention over Memorial Day weekend. This is at the end of the month, end of May. You're getting to be an old man. You're going to be 28 this year?
29.
Oh. 29.
Next year is my dirty 30.
Oh, what are you going to do for it? Any big plans?
For dirty 30?
Yeah.
That's a year away.
Are any big plans for this birthday coming up?
No, I don't have anything major. I've got nothing planned, really.
No travel trips or anything?
No, at the end of June, we're doing a trip. Lauren and I are doing a trip with my family. We're going to do like a heritage tour, like Poland and Czech or whatever it's called now, Czech Republic.
Yeah, the Czech Republic. It's
going
to be...
We're going to Prague.
Prague is gorgeous.
I've heard that. Yeah, we're going to, I think, Vienna and some other places like that. So that'll be fun.
That's going to be so great.
Yeah, that'll be fun. But other than that...
Yeah, if you guys... If you want to see me in real life, come to MegaCon.
Go to MegaCon. Say hi to Tana. Yep. And if you mention this podcast,
yes,
Tana will give you something.
I will give you something. I'll give you a comic book. I'll give you a silk print. I'll give you something.
Yeah. She'll give you a hug.
I'll give you a high fives are free.
Oh, not hugs, though?
No hugs. I'm across the table. It makes for an awkward...
You can't, like, walk around
it. It's a reach.
Not
really, because you're in kind of blocks of tables. Oh, so, okay. Yeah, it'd be more awkward to... But sometimes you're on an end or something and you have, but I don't know what the floor plan looks like yet. All right. They haven't released it.
Anything new in work that you can tell us about? Anything exciting coming up? Or?
Working on my I do have a project. I think it's being announced soon. I don't think it's been announced yet, but it's excellent. It's phenomenal. I'm doing the best work of my career on it and I'm very excited about it.
Awesome.
So, be on the lookout. I'll make an announcement here when the time is right.
Follow at Tana Ford.
Yep.
You can check her out, Tana Ford Designs on Facebook.
Yeah.
And just all around, she's an amazing person.
And
are you going to be
live streaming any of your video games?
Probably not, because I'm lazy.
I'm not doing that these days.
I'm not really that cool anymore.
Well,
you're cool enough for the both of us. So.
Oh man, nope. This drink
looks like nothing to me.